What I want to try to do is to say a little bit about decision-making from the perspective of neuroscience, and to sort of go down from the psychological level and to try to say a little bit about how, from a slightly different perspective, we might be able to look at some of these questions. So for those of us who have paddled around a little bit in computational neuroscience, I think what we find to be a useful way of thinking about decision making, both in animals and in humans, is that it is a kind of constraint satisfaction process. It's not, needless to say, to be modeled as a deductive process, but as a constraint satisfaction process where a number of constraints involving such things as a variety of emotions or drives, not all of which may be consistent, past memories and experiences, expectations and predictions, all come into play, and there is a kind of settling effect into a minimum. And that minimum constitutes the decision.
I mean, the neuroscience isn't a decision. It's a motivation. It supplies not the decisions, but the motives. Once you have the motivation, there are other very strong sources of motivation, which if you marshal them correctly, you suddenly get religion, or you suddenly, the scales fall from your eyes somehow. And there's a study of, say, Orthodox Jews who'd never smoke on the Sabbath. Don't get craving on the Sabbath, because this is a confident self-control situation where a reminder of the cigarette doesn't cause any kind of wavering in expectation of smoking. And so you don't get this conditioned response miraculously. There's a lot of physical factors in addiction, but we also have to account for how these things wind up being what looks like, in effect, free will. I mean, you can have, who could tell that the addict who'd been doing it for years and years, one day, and which day will it be, stops. That's what people who advocate free will tend to bring up as an example. Look at how this happens. And it's not that it is free in the sense of undetermined, it's that you cannot account for the decision in terms of the just adding up the factors that go into that moment. That within the moment there's an interaction of the factors that also can change things radically one way or another, which is the thing that I'm trying to model.
But don't you think that there are some grounds for, shall we say, skepticism about the first person reports about what really the cause was of his being able to stop smoking, or the first person report of the nature of the interplay of factors that went into being able to make a decision to do thus and such? I mean, the fact is that we know from a lot of psychological work from social psychologists and others that these kinds of introspective reports are often very unreliable. And even though they may seem intuitively sort of within a folk psychological framework to kind of hold together, so, you know, he must be thinking this and he's got to be thinking that and this must be discounted relative to that. I mean, I guess at some point I'd like to know whether that's really testable. You know, do we just take the addict's word for it that this is the thought process he went through? Or might it really be the case that, you know, there was some kind of fundamental internal change in your miraculous addict that suddenly quit after years? I mean, all kinds of things could happen. There's a change in diet, there's a change with age, there's all kinds of changes that might well be responsible. But what humans, of course, are really good at is invoking folk psychology to give an explanation that seems plausible within the framework of folk psychology. We all say, wow, yeah, you just got right in there and strengthened your will and did it. Good on you. I mean, what the heck is that?
Yeah, no, this is certainly true, that we have a lot of tendency to make up stories about ourselves, and hypnotic subjects can be made to explain things that were actually suggested to them, and they weren't aware of that, and so they'll come up with a confabulation for it. And yeah, there's lots of false information. I think the task of a thought experiment, for instance, is to remove that kind of overlay and get to a place where it's one in himself can just say, well, given this condition, like the angel whispering in your ear whether you'd smoke again or not, whether that universally causes the response, oh, well, in that case, I could smoke, or in that case, I wouldn't.
I don't Without think it's rational being, like that. I don't think addicts are not okay. going through that kind of process, I suspect.
There's a lot of irrational things. There's some very, very convincing stories, however. David Primack had a story from quite a while ago that sometimes cited of a father who smoked and drove by his children in the rain. He was going to pick them up, and it was raining. They were there in the rain getting dripped on. And he realized he was out of cigarettes. And he said, okay, I'll just run down to the store, you know, the next block and pick up some cigarettes and then come back and pick them up. And when he noticed he was doing that, had such revulsion that he stopped his smoking at that moment. Now, it could have been that's when the pituitary tumor broke. There are some things that seem to be also convincing as introspection.
He probably wanted to quit for a long time. It was a rainy day and it was gloomy. He was probably reminded of, you know, nasty things happening and kids getting killed with cars in the rain and oh my God and all this stuff. I mean, who knows?
But the self-signaling was fairly convincing too.
What?
The self-signaling was also fairly convincing. The moment that made the difference between his long-term wanting to stop and his actually stopping at that moment was a self-signal that if I am the kind of father who does this, I can't stand that. I could not stand categorizing myself as that kind of father.
But the trouble with, I'm sort of flat-footed enough to want data for something like that. That when people tell me what the explanation was for this major change in their life, I mean, we all know how to make up the right story. You know, why did you marry so-and-so instead of so-and-so?
Yeah, yeah.
And so, but then it turns out that when you look at the data about why people marry this person rather than that person, these non-conscious factors end up playing a huge role. And who you marry, of course, is a fairly major decision in your life. And my guess is that we need to be a little bit circumspect about first-person reports, especially when they border on the miraculous. We need to be a little bit circumspect about them and say, let's figure out an experiment, psychological albeit, where we could actually test that. And I want to see the data on it. Because we know that there are so many of these non-conscious factors that in normal decision making, and particularly also in, as it were, heavy decision making, that play a really, really important role.